Let me come to my presentation, and that's a joint work with many colleagues, mostly from Grenoble. And this is a brief review of the level set method for shape ontology optimization, and then some details about how we try to incorporate manufacturing constraints in those optimization algorithms. So the content will be first, I mean, I will go very quickly because additive manufacturing, I think everybody more or less knows what it is. Then I will come back to the level set method for shape ontology optimization. Then I will discuss all work, just to explain that I'm not completely new in the business of geometrical constraint, but I'm new in additive manufacturing, right? And then I will come back to our last works on the constraint coming from additive manufacturing. And then this is ongoing work. I mean, some of the constraints that I'm presenting there are not that efficient, so I will skip them in the future, but okay, we tried them, so I just want to show the results. Good, so additive manufacturing. I'm mostly interested by metallic power bed fusion. So there is a slicing process, you know that, right? Some pictures, okay, maybe I don't need to discuss so much in this audience. Just to tell you that shape ontology optimization are very, very popular in industry since at least 20-25 years ago. And so here are two slides that I've taken from some colleagues, one in Renault and another one in Airbus. So you see some application of topology optimization to design the reinforcement of the rear door of some car. And this was a rib reinforcement of the wing of the Airbus A380. Okay. But also, you know, those tools are very much used in industry. There are still some painting issues, and the biggest issue probably is manufacturability. Robustness is also an issue, which was discussed by Rodrigo, by the way, you know, when you have, according to mechanical engineers, the thing that you know least in this problem is what are really the forces, where are they applied, what are the magnitude, the orientation. So a lot of uncertainties, so robustness with respect to the uncertainties is a very important issue. I will not talk about this today. Classical constraint, molding constraint. So typically, you know, this the gray part in my pictures are the molds, and the white part inside is the cast part, that is the structure that you want to build. And typically, you may have several molds, right? Here there are three molds, and at each mold you associate a direction, a parting direction, that is the direction in which you remove the mold. And of course, you are doing mass production, so you don't want to break either the molds or the metallic part. Oops, sorry. So on the left, this is a moldable part, a castable part. Oh, my goodness, sorry. And on the right, this is non-castable because you have some interior void, you have undercut, so you cannot remove this mold in the direction, my goodness, which is here. And so a moldability condition will be that everywhere on the boundary of your structure, the cast part, the normal in the direction of the exterior should make a scalar product with the direction of parting that should be with a scalar product that should be positive, so you could remove without breaking it. Okay, so that's one example of classical geometrical constraint for which I will show some example, another example in the end. Okay, so what is shape ontology optimization? Well, typically when you optimize, you have to choose an objective function. Rodrigo told you that you can choose compliance, which is indeed a very popular measure of global rigidity, but there are others, okay? I'm not going to discuss them that much. But typically, when you minimize this objective function, you have also constraint. And those constraints could be also in terms of PDE, the linearized elastic system, that could be thermal problems or even thermal elasticity problem, right? And so the difficulty of this business is that also the shape is a variable of optimization. You compute either the objective function or the constraint in terms of the solution of a PDE posed in the domain omega. So that means that computing gradients is not an easy matter. That's the purpose of control theory, so adjunct method, all this business. So I'm not going to go into the details, but you may imagine that there is a lot of mathematics behind. My model will be linearized elasticity. There are also some other non-linearized elasticity, contact problems, plasticity, nonlinear geometric deformation, and so on and so forth. I'm not going to discuss that much. Here is a classical problem, right? Typically, cantilever, you are clamped on the left, you apply some vertical load on the right, and the dash part of the boundary is a free boundary, that the one that you optimize typically. Okay. Level set method. So the previous talk was more or less using the SIMP method, so it was not set, but since this is in collaboration with colleagues from DTU, that was a SIMP method, that is, you were optimizing the density of material at every point. Here, there will be no density of material, there will be either pure material or pure void, and the boundary will be represented by the zero level set of a function defined everywhere. So here is the definition of the level set function. That's a function that will be zero on the boundary, negative inside and positive outside. So that's a way of representing, parameterizing a shape. This method was devised by Osher and Sitian for completely different purposes. This was for a combustion problem, a fluid mechanical problem, on the first references on the use of the level set method for structural optimization are those here, so at the beginning of the years 2000. Okay, what is nice with, what is nice with this level set method is that if you want to move the boundary of a shape, the only thing that matters is the normal velocity. A tangential velocity is just a reparametrization of the same shape, okay? A tangential velocity means you're just rotating but not moving the shape. So only the only thing that matters is a normal velocity that I call capital V, and it's an easy matter to show that the equation to that correspond to moving the boundary in the normal direction with a velocity v is equivalent to solve this Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is a nonlinear equation because you have this modulus of the gradient here. And the nice thing with this is that this equation has global solution in time, and that it will take into account automatically topology changes. That's why the level set method is very popular in many different fields. That's because topology changes. Here, it will be clear what it means. We have already seen some pictures, but in other contexts, like in fluid mechanics, that will be merging bubbles, for example, that will be automatically taken into account by the level set formalism. Now, the main question here is, what is V? What is the velocity? The velocity is coming from the optimization problem. It's not a physical velocity. It's a question of optimization, and how do you compute gradients, or how do you minimization among shapes? Well, there is a well-known method that goes back to Adamard, which is to parameterize variation of a shape starting from a reference shape omega zero by vector field theta. So that means that from your reference domain omega zero, you move every point x to a new position x plus theta of x. Theta is a vector field, which is a displacement, a bit like in elasticity. And then, once you have parameterized your structure by this vector field, then differentiating with respect to a shape is like it's by definition differentiating with respect to the vector field theta. So I skip the details and I just tell you that by a theorem, which is called the Adamard structure theorem, any shape derivative, whatever the function that you differentiate, any shape derivative in the direction of a vector field theta is always of the type an integral on the boundary of the normal component of the vector field times some integrand j, and then j may be very complicated depending on the solution of your PDE, on the adjoint equation, and so on and so forth. But once you know this, now you have a good choice to get a decent direction to minimize your objective function, which is to take the direction of derivation theta to be proportional to n times j. J is a scalar here, n is a vector, and with a minus sign in order to get a negative derivative, right? So the velocity is minus j. So you go to your favorite book on shape optimization. I have a nice book if you're interested. And you compute by the standard method of control, optimal control, this shape derivative. So you find what is the j according to your objective function and to your constraint. And then you just plug this velocity v equal minus j in your level set method, and you are in a good position to start optimization. So here are some results where you find very complicated shape with very complicated topologies that will be very hard to manufacture by traditional means. So that's a good motivation for additive manufacturing. Just let me show one example because you know, we've been talking about nice dynamics. So let me show you another one. where is this? This one. Yeah. It's a 3D one done in collaboration with Charles Daponi and Pascal Frey. So the blue upper part is clamped. You have a vertical load which is applied here, and you see starting from some holes. You don't see the exterior boundary, you only see the internal boundary. Starting from some internal holes, you build a very nice truss structure which is optimal for minimal compliance under a volume constraint, right? By the way, dynamics is fascinating, but dynamics is not completely physical in the sense that dynamic reflects your optimization algorithm. If I change the optimization algorithm, I will change the dynamic. It's fascinating, I agree, but it's mostly reflecting the optimization algorithm, which I'm not discussing here. Okay, geometric constraints. So there are many works, and let me tell you, but you may know that, I say that for people in mechanics, that there are already many ideas in image processing, okay? And one of the nice ideas is that since we are using the velocity function, we are very well aware of the so-called sine distance function, that is the distance that you compute to the boundary of your structure. So for example, on the left, you have a structure in black in some rectangular domain. And so here on the right, you have the level set of the sine distance function. So it's clear that, for example, in the middle of every bar, that's the maximum absolute value of the distance. So that gives you the definition of half the thickness. So by the sine distance function, you have some geometrical information. And so we exploited this idea. For example, we could say that if we want to have a maximal thickness constraint, then remember the sine distance function is negative inside. So a maximal thickness constraint would be to say everywhere in my structure I want the sine distance to the boundary to be larger than minus d max divided by 2. If this is satisfied at any point inside the structure, but of course the point where the constraint has a tendency to be violated would be at the middle, you know, on what is called the ridge of this structure, the skeleton of this structure. So if it is satisfied everywhere, you have a definition of a maximal thickness d max. Minimal thickness would be a bit more complicated. Here is a gray structure, and so minimal thickness, you start from a point x on the boundary, you move inside, in the direction opposite to the exterior normal, up to a distance d of, and then you compute, is the sine distance positive or negative? If it is negative, you are inside the structure. If it is positive, you are outside. On my picture, you are outside. So that means that the constraint is violated. Okay. So the constraint is that for every point on the boundary, if you move inside by a distance d of, you should still have a negative sine distance. And then d of is any parameter between 0 and d min. Why not jumping directly to d min? That's because you may have two bars at a distance d min, and so you jump over the hole, you don't see it. So the minimal thickness is not d min, you are just lucky that there is another bar at a distance d min. So you should check that for every offset distance between 0 and d min, which is a constraint that you want to enforce. Okay, so then there are classical ways of computing derivatives according to the shape to implement those constraints in optimization. I skip the details. Here is a classical example, another one compared to the cantilevers. This is a so-called MBB beam. So that's half of the domain. You should symmetrize it. You know, this indication that it is symmetrized. You have a load, a vertical load applied on the top, and it's fixed. Well, it's on the roller, so that's only the vertical displacement is zero. And starting from this initialization, where I put many holes just to not influence the topology, you get this structure where on purpose I choose a volume constraint which is very large, so you have very thick bars. And then I apply, starting from the same initialization, the optimization process with the constraint on maximal thickness. So that's again the one that you've seen on the previous slide without constraint. And here, from left to right and top to bottom, you get a more strict constraint, and you see that indeed the thickest bar are here and there. They got thinner, but since the volume is the same, you have more bars. Okay, just to tell you that, of course, you change completely the design if you have such type of constraint. Minimal thickness, again, on the top left, this is without constraint, with a different volume. So I choose this volume because I have very thin bars, and then I input, I enforce minimal thickness constraint, which are more and more strict. So that means less and less bars because the volume is the same. Okay. So just to tell you that works. Molding constraint, I already discussed this. So this is the moldability condition. I do not give the details on how I apply this constraint, but let me simply show a typical result. That's a box where the four lower corners are fixed, and in the middle you have a vertical load, and that's the solution that you obtain for minimizing compliance, that is maximizing rigidity with a volume constraint and no molding constraint. On the bottom left, I put a molding constraint, and the mold is just one mold, starting from the bottom, and you take it up, okay? And on the right, you have two molds separated by a vertical plane. The upper mold, of course, goes up, and the lower mold goes down. So you clearly get a different result. I have a small movie, if you like. I'm using LaTeX and I still have problems to incorporate movies in my LaTeX. That's the first one where there is only one mold. So you see the evolution, so starting from some initialization, right? And the second one is with two molds, right? Oh, that's a bit fast. Okay, now constraint for additive manufacturing. There are many of them. Here is a list of some of them, the one that I know. Preferred orientation of thin or slender structures. It's known that typically if you want, you know, if you build in a vertical direction, horizontal bars are a little bit more complicated to build than vertical bars. Overhang limitation, this was already discussed, I'll show you something. Thermal residual stresses, very important. I have no computation here, but we are working on it. Minimal time for the trajectory of the laser or the electron beam when you build, because you don't want to spend too much energy. Removing the powder at the end of the process, no closed hole. Okay. The previous geometrical constraint may be helpful, but they are clearly not enough. So here are some ideas. The first idea is to use when you do additive manufacturing by powder bed melting is to use an anisotropic distance. You know, I computed minimal and maximal thickness with a uniform, with a usual Euclidean distance, which is isotropic. Now you may favor the horizontal or the vertical direction in order to favorize, for example, vertical bars compared to horizontal bars. So the idea is to fix an anisotropic distance with a given matrix M. You compute the distance now according to this matrix M, right? And for example here, in 2D, let's take a distance that will encourage vertical bars. And why? Because it will compute a distance in the horizontal direction that will be smaller than in the vertical direction. And then I come up again with a maximal thickness criteria, except that my thickness is now computed with this non-isotropic distance. So here are some examples. This one is not very nice, unfortunately. So that's a typical cantilever structure where you apply two loads, not simultaneously. You have two state equations for the two loads applied differently. That's the standard solution on the left when you have no constraint on the thickness. And on the right, that's the one that you get with a constraint on the thickness, which is not an isotropic one. So a priori, you favor vertical bars compared to horizontal one. It's not clear that this design is easier to manufacture. It turns out that in 3D it was working very well for some reason. That's a project where some students, it was a student project where they wanted to design some bridge. So you have the upper face where you have a uniform pressure load, four lower corners which are clamped. And here is a structure that you get without any constraint on thickness. And so you see that one thing which is not very nice is that we have bars which are a bit thicker than the other ones. So if you want to have more uniform bars, then a possibility would be to enforce this maximal thickness with an anisotropic thickness. Here, that's one design with the first anisotropic tensor here, and the second one here with the second anisotropic tensor, so which is very anisotropic, and this one is easier to manufacture. And it turns out that actually the compliances are very similar. The figures are not very changed, so we were very happy in this case. By the way, here is a construction made by the students on some additive machine at Deco Polytechnique. You see that there is a very bad printing, of course, due to overhang, so that's a very good introduction to overhang's limitation. And so I'm going to show you two constraints in order to limit overhangs, one which is based on the normal angle, another one which is more interesting because it has more application, that will be a constraint based on the additive process where you build your structure layer by layer. Okay, geometric constraints on the normal angle. So the idea would be that if your draw direction, your build direction is D, you want the normal to make an angle with D that is less than phi, so typically the scalar product N times D should be less than the cosinus of phi. Then you take the part where you select the point where this is a pointwise constraint, by the way. So you just want to aggregate it in a single constraint. So you just take the places where the point x where this is violated, that's a positive part. You square it, and then you integrate it over the entire boundary. So if this is zero, your pointwise constraint is okay. If this is not zero, you have a problem. But the point is that we want to result to show you if you're interested. But we are in the process of finishing it, and so we are in this concept of computing performance for every intermediate structure using a thermoelastoplastic model. And the final residual stresses will be the plastic deformation that are irreversible, so that will stay in the end. Here are a list of a few references on those sets. And by the way, about beauty, I'm not an expert in aesthetics or beauty, but let me quote this work with Agnès Couvelas, who is an architect. So architects are also using shape and topology optimization, and so there are some ideas there to, well, not aesthetics, but let's say architectural design. Thank you for your attention.